all is at peace with God. Everything is totally at peace with God. Always, right now. If you think of God as pure spaciousness, everything is equally abiding in pure spaciousness right now. It is all at peace, completely at peace. There's no way you can get out of sorts with pure spaciousness. There's no way that anywhere can ever get out of sorts, out of adjustment, out of alignment with pure spaciousness. It's completely impossible. So everything is already at peace with God. There's absolutely nothing anyone needs to do in order to make this so. There's absolutely no changes that need to take place in order for this to be so. And it will always be so, no matter what apparent changes, relative changes are made anywhere. It doesn't affect this in the slightest bit. It's very important to keep this in mind. Also, keep in mind that all is totally free. All unmanifest can be manifest at any instant without depleting the unmanifest. All manifest can become unmanifest this any instant without depleting, without somehow harming the unmanifest or losing the ability to be manifest. And spirit is entirely free to play with this manifest-unmanifest dynamic. Do whatever it wants to do every instant. There's no limits, no restrictions whatsoever. Therefore, how can we be defined what we are? How can what we are be defined? How can it be defined when what we are is this perfect freedom to be whatever we want to be in terms of experiencing forever with no definition of what we have to do or not do? See, there cannot be a definition of what we are. So when we try to define what we are, this is what gets us in trouble. We try to define reality. Reality is indefinable, completely indefinable. Again, because there's absolute freedom to manifest everything or not manifest everything with no restrictions ever in any way. So you can't define pure freedom, can you? Because you're always free to do whatever you want. How can you define that? It is ridiculous. We wanted to be greater than God, and so what we did was we put definitions on God and said God's restricted, that we're free, but God is not free. So we tried to define our freedom that we are, and when we tried to do this, then we felt our definitions were superior, our definitions became what our identity is. Actually, we believe our identity are these definitions. Okay, this is how we're, and then we're then looking at the definitions, and then we feel by observing the definitions that we've defined that we're then greater than God, greater than what we are. So when we want to be greater than all it is, we then make a definition of all it is, then be the observer or the one who is making the definition and thinking that one is prior to, greater to, greater than what is being defined. The problem is we believe that dropping the definitions would result in a complete abyss for the one who believes that definitions are identity. You see, definition is identity. At least the identity of God, spirit, reality. See, we think we're better than that. But to drop definition, we'd say, well, identity is just this, there's no identity. You know, we'd say that there's no definable identity. So we define it then as an abyss. Our total chaos. An abyss of total chaos is how we then would try to define reality. So this then causes us to try to define more and more and more and more, to try to embed identity in definition, in form. Formatted. So we believe that what we are is something that is formatted, that is form. We believe that we're bodies. We believe the body is part of this world. It's all, you know, nature. It's all this format. And we believe without it, we would be this abyss of total chaos. We'd be plunged in an abyss of total chaos. Well, So you can see how those who believe that are fanatically opposed to dropping definition and interpretation, fanatically opposed to formlessness, and hugely boosterish to formatting and form, and clinging to that. And so you have very much different viewpoints depending on whether you want to try to be greater than God, which necessitates then this definition and then the fear of the abyss and the obsession with form and bodies and things, and, or you repent and you say, no, I don't want to be greater than God. I accept that God is all that is, and therefore I am all that is too. All that is all that is. And then you don't, it doesn't feel like there's an abyss of chaos. It doesn't feel that way. You say, no, there's no problem at all. Everything is just complete fullness, complete support, complete peace, complete stability, utter complete stability everywhere, total non-chaos everywhere, perfect non-chaos, perfect non-chaos, perfect non-abyss everywhere, always. That's what you see. No need to define anything. Everything is already perfect. Why do you need to try and define anything? See, so there's a complete difference there in belief systems and in, you know, apples and oranges. So that needs to be kept in mind. Why you see there's very much divergence in this world. Huge divergence. Now there's always attempts to restructure in this world. We want to, the world wants to, those who have the fear of the abyss want to structure things in such a way that the message of salvation from this irrational, false, delusional fear of the abyss, of chaos, that we can work through that and we can recognize it's only our continuity fear. There's really no abyss there at all. It's our continuity fear. And stop projecting our continuity fear out as if it were some abyss. Stop using the world as an excuse to avoid, you know, reality. They want to format that out, completely out of the world. They feel the world of form is their haven. It's their sanctuary, their haven. And they don't want that to any fear. They think they can be happy if they just keep out the ideology entirely of salvation, because they feel that that threatens them with the abyss of chaos, that's been pushed into it, because they don't realize it's what they really have is a continuity fear. There is no abyss. There's only a continuity fear. So these mindsets, this belief, those who have this belief system of fear of the abyss, wanting to be greater than God, leads to the fear of this fear, irrational fear of an abyss, which isn't there. They want to restructure. They want to structure wherever they are. Wherever they are, they want to structure everything they can as much as possible to eliminate any ideology that says that you know that's pointing towards formlessness. Okay, beyond definition. Non-dual absolute. Of course, what is non-dual absolute? There isn't any definition. Definitions take their meaning from more and less, from duality. Even when we say word oneness, we can always contrast that with two-ness, you know, right? But the absolute non-dual, there is no definition of it at all. It just is. So they view that with great alarm. And they want to structure, wherever they are, they want to structure that out, format it out. So in this world right now, we have a lot of people here, those spirits here who believe in, they're prideful, arrogant, prideful, want to be greater than God. They carry this great sin, a mistake of believing there's an abyss. And they have extreme fear of this abyss. And they're fanatically obsessed with trying to reformat this planet to get rid of any spiritual teachings which point to reality. They feel threatened by that. So they're working on a way to accomplish this reformatting. You have to understand, this is the context of the world right now. It's always been that way to a greater or lesser degree, but right now it's to an extreme, alarming extent right now. And so you have to believe that to reformat, the first thing to do is crash the system, and by doing so, gain more control over it. It's sort of like when the banks in the 2008 recession, they brought about this mini crash, and they were able to consolidate the power of the bigger banks. They crushed a lot of the smaller banks, like the so-called middle tier banks. A lot of them were crushed very badly. So it was sort of a reformatting of the financial landscape. But they want to do that on a much grander scale, a global scale. They want to get total control over the planet, economically, healthcare-wise, politically, religious, every facet of the planet. They want to reformat it, restructure it in such a manner as so they can feel comfortable with the structuring of it, meaning there's nothing in there that points to salvation, actual salvation, which is what makes them feel uncomfortable, because they wrongly, being unrepentant, being still prideful, spiritually prideful, they don't recognize that all they really have is a continuity problem. As soon as you recognize that, then everything changes for you in terms of how you feel, just like, oh wow, I don't have an fear of an abyss. There's no abyss. Then you love spiritual teachings. You love it. It's super helpful to you. Take to it like a duck takes to water. But you have to repent first. The unrepentant cannot take the spiritual teaching like a duck takes to water. It's impossible. They will intellectualize. They'll keep it dualistically, contrast, 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 not realizing we're talking about a singularity. We're pointing to a singularity, just one singularity. God is just absolute singularity. We're pointing to that absolute non-dual singularity. They keep whatever they get, it's being processed dualistically, and doesn't help. That doesn't help. So one has to repent in order to really approach the teachings of singularity, that point to singularity, to benefit from them. You have to repent. You have to see your only problem is the continuity problem. This brings just amazing recentering. You recenter yourself. You find yourself a new center. Repentance is a new center for you. To see, realize the only problem anyone has is the continuity problem. It's just like, oh, wow. It is so wonderful to see that. And it's true. Nobody has any problem except the continuity problem. There isn't any abyss at all. So those who insist they have this terrible problem of the abyss and the abyss of chaos, it's not true. They do not have that problem. Their problem is pride. Well, and that too is held in place by the continuity problem. So even pride's not a problem. It's just that their continuity fear is so severe that they just don't feel like they're able to. They don't see how it's possible to solve it. You see, let's put it this way. Everybody knows deep down that they have a continuity problem, but it can appear to be so severe that you feel there's just no possibility of ever resolving it, so it's better not to even acknowledge it. Like, who wants to acknowledge an unsolvable problem, right? Nobody wants to do that. So they will put on this front like, oh no, we don't have any continuity fear problem. We got the fear of the abyss, but that's okay. We're restructuring the world to get rid of that fear. And they'll keep going that way. So what's super important is to realize the continuity problem can be resolved. So how I've benefited is I came across great teachers who had no continuity problem. They had resolved it entirely, and they knew exactly how to resolve it. And so I had faith. I said, hey, and the Holy Spirit told me, hey, guaranteed out, you will be able to resolve this problem. And so I realized, I just said, they're telling me the truth, even though it seems impossible. I said, it's to me, I said, this just seems impossible. I can't see how it can be ever resolved. It's so severe. And the Holy Spirit told me, don't worry. I see exactly how it can be resolved. And I certainly will show you, and we'll get this resolved. And so I said, okay, I believe you. I believe you. Because I know the ego's lying. I know the ego is lying about the chaotic abyss, that this is not anything that we can truly experience more than the instant in our imagination, which I experienced. And the idea of abiding in that and structuring in something is not doable at all. So to be aware of those who have succeeded in resolving the continuity fear is of utmost importance. Utmost importance, which is why my whole life I promoted the teaching about saints and sages and Mahatmas, illumined, ascended masters, illumined ones, realized ones, self-realized ones, enlightened, those in nirvana, samadhi, the bodhisattvas, the saviors, the avatars, you know, on and on and on. I've my whole life has been trying to promote that, because only in this way, basically, and along with the Holy Spirit, can we get the sense of, hey, you know what, it's doable, I can do it. Ultimately, it's the inner experiences you have in the Holy Spirit that convinces you can do it. But the fact that there's many have done it, is very helpful, extremely helpful. The restructuring, the reformatting that's being done on this planet is an attempt to get rid of all of that, which is a disaster, because what will happen is those with this extremely severe continuity fear will feel it's impossible. They see no evidence of anyone doing it. And they'll say, well, I can't do it then, it's impossible. So I'm not going to acknowledge I even have this problem. And then they'll go all in with structuring and reformatting and identifying with form, which then brings about what's called another cycle. So I've done everything I could possibly do, and it's been futile. I feel like I'm fighting against, you know, overwhelming odds. I tried to spread the pictures of saints, you know, on the internet. I've just tried everything on the internet, and it really never takes off. Because it seems those who are doubling down on form and reformatting and belief that they can't do it, you know, are in the ascendancy here, this planet. It's like the dark ages here. Super dark ages. And it's like everybody's like underwater. It's interesting. I had a dream last night and I got information about a tsunami. And I'm sure if it's a prediction, like that we're gonna have a literal tsunami in the ocean. A tsunami can also mean everybody suddenly gets put underwater very severely. Now, underwater can mean several things. It can mean debt. It can mean debt or submerged in such a way as you can't see above water. You can't see. Excuse me. Your viewpoint has you're submerged into darkness. I mean, you go deep enough into water, everything seems quite murky and dark. So it could be referring to that. There's going to be a massive submergence in the world. Also, smoke, it was shown to me like a smoke gets in your eyes. Smokiness means you can't see, everything seems dark. Well, there's no greater darkness than being unaware of the historical, religious, spiritual tradition of this planet. That's incredible darkness. Because that puts you into the darkness of feeling that the continuity problems is too severe to be resolved, and there's no evidence. That's the worst darkness there is, because that's the only problem that we have. And to believe that we can't solve the only problem that we have is the greatest darkness there is. So I have just relentlessly tried to tell people, hey, look, these the saints have been here just recently, but the people here more recently in this world, They don't even acknowledge the past. See, this is the bizarre. The purpose of the people who've come in recently is to reformat this world. They're so identified with form, they're preconditioned to not even look to see if there's any evidence. They're convinced it's impossible to solve the continuity problem. Therefore, they say, there can't be any evidence of it. And so I'm not going to even waste my time looking for what can't exist. You see, this, they've gone this deep into darkness. This is severe darkness. Now, I was fortunate. My dad was a raconteur, a spiritual raconteur. He had a massive repertoire of talks about historical spirituality. This saint, this sage, you know, this Zen master, that, you know, from you know, and so, and I love that, and I also just dug into that, and it makes you feel like this planet's a spiritual planet. There have been so many great realized masters throughout history, which is true. There's truth. It's very true. It's very interesting what's happened. There was this teacher, as we know, the Dafri John teacher, that also brought up the past of all these lineages of the history of the spiritual planet, the spiritual history of the planet, called the Basket of Tolerance series, and published a lot. And I said, wow, that's great. Except his whole purpose was to claim that he was greater than any of these. He said, yeah, there's been all these great teachers, but I'm the very best, and no one will ever be as great as I am. And he acted in such a way as to actually discredit spirituality. Like, kind of think like, whoa, you know, he's promoting all of this, and then but saying he's better than none of them, and you know, sort of a spiritual megalomania, like, I need to rule over all this, I'm here to rule all that, and it sort of tainted, it sort of felt like it tainted and corrupted the whole spiritual history of the planet. So in some ways, it's like, that was like subverting the whole situation. And you know, since then, it's really, the whole planet's gone downhill, because I think it turned a lot of people off. These gurus who claim that they're greater than everybody, it turns everybody off. And then it gives a black eye to the spirituality and spiritual history of the planet. And then makes the job so much more difficult for those who are trying to promote it. And saying, you know, you can do this too. Whereas if you get somebody saying, I am the greatest, nobody can ever be as great as I am, and you always have to be subservient to me, and serve me, and be under me, and all, you say, wow, you know, what's the use of that? And it just sort of collapses your spiritual will. It's very, very nasty, you know. At least that's a perspective that I have experienced on it. And if I'm stand corrected, I'll stand corrected on this. But most certainly, that's the feeling that I've got, that the world is turned, you know, abruptly away from that, and it kind of gives everyone a great excuse to just dump on it. You know, oh yeah, those like really bad people, those spiritual masters, they're crazy, they're insane, they do all sorts of horrible stuff. You know, it's a form of mental illness. And on and on and on and on. So I try to counter that by showing people, you know, really great spiritual masters, and say, hey, you know, that they're not that way. They're tremendous. They're wonderful. They're very unassuming. They're very humble, really. A sign of a spiritual master is the great humility, actually. Great humility. I'm nobody. I'm nothing. You know, only God is. There's just God everywhere. You know, which I bring up Sri Sri Ananda Mahima, which is absolute pure humility. He said, I said, no, this is where it's what it's really at. This is what the genuine article is. And that other guy, you know, he was, trying to give spirituality a bad name, actually. In an attempt to promote it, he actually gave it a bad name. Raman Maharshi, so humble, so meek, so humble, knowing all is God. Everyone is equally in God. There's no such thing as higher or lower. There's no such thing as higher or lower. There's no such situation. We don't have to be some great this or great that. Realization is simply right here, right now. All is at peace with God, always. All is at peace with God, always. There's nothing that can change that at all. There's nothing you can do to make it more, nothing you can do to make it less. Anyway, the world has turned away from its spiritual history and legacy. After all, who wants to get the spiritual history and legacy from some megalomaniac who claims that you have to come and worship them and give them all your energy, and that's the only way, and you know, just like, I don't have anything to do with it, that kind of feeling. So that sort of, you know, muddied the waters, and the tech people coming in who convinced that the continuity problem is insolvable, therefore, the only thing to do is just completely get rid of all spiritual teaching, and that'll make us happy, because we'll just be able to somehow say the continuity problem is insolvable, therefore it doesn't exist. So that should make us happy. This is called magical thinking. Okay, so they're basing salvation on magical belief, magical thinking. It doesn't work. The continuity problem has to be solved. Nobody is ever going to be given a pass on that one. It's impossible. It has to be solved. No two ways about it. No two ways about it. And it can be solved, and it will be solved. So you're just wasting your time. When you go into another cycle, you're just wasting your time and making the continuity problem even, you know, more sticky, and yet you still have to solve it. So it's a terrible waste of time. So and yet that's where we're at now. We're at, in a sense, we're ready to reformat. Now, reformatting can be done another number of ways. Basically, crashing the system that's functioning now. And then saying that in order to reformat it, we need, you know, total control. We're going to reformat a different way. And that absolutely, that's the whole plan of the New World Order, is to do this. Basically have a single source that everyone has to turn to for functioning in this world, and then have a basic creed from that source of you know, loyalty. How are you going to get along with that single source? You know, like all fiat money gone, just digital money. How are you going to, you have to play by their rules. In other words, they make the rules, and then if you play by them, you survive. If you don't, you don't survive. And so they're going to, you know, they want to squeeze out anything that makes them feel that the continuity problem can be resolved, because they feel that that's impossible, and therefore it's pushing them into the abyss. They'll interpret it, again, as I've said, if you refuse to recognize the continuity problem, you feel that spiritual teachings is trying to push you into an abyss of chaos. That's what you feel. And of course you're gonna fight against that and try to outlaw whatever is pushing you that way. But if you repent, then you see it's not, there is no abyss, it's not pushing you to any abyss, it's actually bringing you out of your delusional fear. So you realize that no, there's impossible any abyss, everything's a completely full, wonderful, blissful safety. So this is the crossroads that we're at right now. We're at the crossroads. Remember, Christianity, the sign of the cross, is a crossroads. It's a sign of the crossroads. And what Christianity is doing is pointing out this crossroads of how different, how divergent these two ways are. And what Christianity teaches, there's a parting of the ways that will take place. And it pretty much has to, because what we're told on this planet, those who are doubling down on reform and the belief that the continuity problem cannot be solved, therefore they have to double down on definition and form here and reformat religion off of this planet, spiritual teachings off this planet. We're told that they're going to gain ascendancy here on this planet. That was the predictions of Jesus. And that would be the end of time, as it's called, where there'd be very wicked and adulterous generation, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in those days, where people are turned to form, just and turn away from religious, spiritual teachings, basically turn away from evaporating their continuity fear, which is what spiritual practice is all about. They'll turn away from that to an incredible extent, and they will promote the flesh, the form, and say this is where you find happiness, as if you can, and they'll want to eradicate religion and spiritual teaching to make themselves what they feel is comfortable and therefore happy, following the premise, their false premise, which is pride-driven, and ignorance-driven, severe ignorance, unrepentant attitude. So the unrepentant attitude will find a place in this world and will take over this planet, the unrepentant attitude. So what about the ones who have a repentant attitude? What about them? And Jesus says, he when he left here, he said, where are you going? He says, don't worry. There are many rooms in my Father's mansion. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there in the Father's kingdom to prepare a place for you. And then, so when I will come back and I'll take you to dwell in that place with me. So that's pretty cut and dried what he's saying there. Is that he's saying, hey, yeah, this planet, Earth, will be taken over by the unrepentant attitude. Those with repentant attitudes will be shifted into a place that is conducive and welcoming to their repentant attitude, you see. So this is the basic canon of the Christian teachings. And it also seems to be working out. I'm seeming to get some indications of that. Now, like 3 days in a row, it's been, I think it's been three days in a row, or three out of the last 4 days, very strong indications that right next door, so to speak, very close by, is a place for us. When I say us, I mean those who are repentant, who have repented, the repentant. Which means repent. To repent means to say that you admit you have a severe continuity problem, which admits that you tried to be greater than God. It admits that. You said, God, this is what I tried to do, and now I see that it's not doable. So I need to now accept reality as it is instead of a changed reality. But I've been so identifying with definition and defining reality and form, I'm afraid of formlessness and non-definition. So I needed some few steps, you know, intermediate steps. I needed kind of a gradualism to you know, go back to, you know, accepting that, you know, formlessness and reality as it is. That's the repentant attitude. So I say I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. Those are the repentant ones. So I received, it was like, was it 2 nights ago? Or three, could have been 3 nights ago. One, two, yeah, 3 nights ago. A invitation straight from Jesus to come visit his house, his place. So maybe that's how it happens. People actually receive an invitation. I had a dream where he was sitting on the ground. I just came and sat beside him, and we talked, and then I was about to leave, and he said, hey, would you like to come visit my house? And I said, oh yeah, of course, yeah, love to. He said, okay, let's go. So I said, it's very nearby, just right, you know, right around the corner. It's right here. Oh, great. Of course, right around the corner can also mean very soon too. Close at hand, very close at hand. So maybe that's, you know, maybe people in dreams all over the planet are actually having this experience where they meet a Jesus or a figure that represents the path of true salvation through repentance, solving the continuity of fear. And they're being invited, you know, to visit the house, visit their place. And that probably means, you know, that you're prepared. You've prepared properly for it. When you get the invitation, that means you did the right preparation for it. So it's not going to be a problem for you. I feel that way. You know, I don't feel that there's going to be, you know, an irredeemable difficulty, you know, insurmountable difficulty with it. Adjustment, sure, adjustment period, whatever, getting used to anything, familiarity. You go to paradise, you have a familiarity issue. And so, of course, but nothing that's insurmountable or seemingly prohibitively difficult. I don't feel that way at all. Yeah, so repentance is to admit, to recognize you have a continuity problem. That's what real repentance is. The other stuff, saying, oh, I did something bad, like confession, go to confession. Well, you know, I had a greedy thought, I wanted something, I wanted more money. I told a little lie, you know, other stuff like that. And so the stuff they're confessing, you know, that's not where it's at, actually. I mean, that's sort of psychotherapy. It's helpful, that's fine. Get something off your chest you feel guilty about, that's fine. But real repentance has to do with admitting you have a continuity problem. That's the only problem you have. Admitting it's the only problem you have, that's true repentance. That's what gets you into the kingdom of heaven. That's what gets you in the place that Jesus has prepared. So my goal has been to help people, urge people to recognize this. Now, how we recognize it is not necessarily easy. It just sort of dawns upon you. It can just say, you know, somehow, hey, you know, like, wow, I get it. I don't have any real problem. I'm formless. How can I have any problem with form? What I am is formless. It's ridiculous. How can I have a problem with definition? What I am is completely undefinable. So all these things that I think are problems are really not problems in the slightest bit for me. None of it is. However, I cling to it because of the continuity fear. So I do have a continuity problem, but it's the only problem I have. And that puts you in a new center, absolutely new center, it does. And then you can really relate to the great teachers and the great teachings, and it's just like, you just get it. You say, oh yeah. I get that. Oh yeah, I get that. Sure. And you just become very open, and it becomes easy for you. You know, you no longer need to process it dualistically, because that all that is trying to say, well, how do I apply this teaching to all my problems? You see? You don't have all those problems. You only have the continuity problem. So when you get the teaching and you say, well, how do I apply this to the only problem that I have, the continuity problem? Then it fits, and you say, oh, that's easy. I can apply that to the continuity problem, easy. Yeah, that works great. That's not a problem. It's when you try to apply it to all the problems you think you have, it doesn't work, it doesn't fit, and it just drives you crazy. And the spiritual path seems just like impossibly difficult. So it has to be stressed that true repentance is absolutely necessary. There's no way around it. Otherwise, you're just going to be a dilettante amateur. You'll play with spiritual teachings. You'll talk shop, spiritual shop. And it's all intellectual. It's all dualistic. And you're thinking about, well, how can I apply this to this problem in the world? How can I apply it to that problem in the world? And you might get a little thing, well, if I just kind of be nice to people, that'll work. Or maybe I just need to, you know, fill this and that. And you'll try to just sort of give this sort of meat, watered down, mishy, mushy, you know, sentiment, kind of like, yeah, maybe we can help, this might help some of the problems. There's nothing there, there's no escape velocity there at all. You'd be left in this utterly watered down, madness, you know, that gets nowhere. Totally stagnant. Happens and you become apostate. You basically go, you know, I think that these secular humanists have a lot better ideas than I do. For me, it's just like, well, you know, trying to be nice, but a lot of times I don't like other people, and I just can't seem to make it work. It just seems like ineffectual, you know. I can't seem to apply it. I can't seem to get spiritual teaching to really apply it in the right way to the world. And yeah, I try to, you know, bring a few canned goods in and donate and give to some charities and stuff. But it seems like the secular humanists, they're able to organize everything way better. And they're able to, you know, because they're all about form, you know, trying to make form happy. And so people fall away, because they never got it in the first place. They never really repented in the first place. So that's why what John the Baptist said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This repentance is all important. And it may take you, you know, a great effort to get to the repentance. I've struggled with it my entire life. Finally have gotten to accept, you know, to repent and accept the continuity problem is the only problem there is. I lean more that way than not, which is repentance. You're not expected to be 100% repentant. You lean that more way than not. And you fundamentally, that's your center. You're fundamentally centered in that. So, this is what it takes. But then, all the teachings make sense, and you get it. And the non-dual absolute attracts you, and you say, that's not too difficult. I'm evaporating my continuity fear. I'll keep evaporating it, and I can see the progress, and I see that I'm getting there, actually. I mean, I'm actually seeing that I'm getting there. I'm getting there. Of course, ultimately you realize there's nowhere to get. So I'm getting to the point where I realize there's nowhere to get. And there's no point there either. Getting to the point where I realize there is no point. In fact, there's never been a point. There's never been anything to get, anywhere to get. So getting to acceptance of that. There's nothing to accept because there's no definition. Everything is perfect. Everything is. That's why we say don't take a picture of anything. A picture is a definition, right? A picture is a limitation. It's a definition. It's an interpretation, definition. It's framed by time. What we are is completely timeless. It cannot be defined. We are 100% free every instant. What appears in any instant does not define us in the slightest bit, because we're in totally free every moment to manifest or unmanifest whatever we want to. So how can you say that this, any appearance, defines us, or defines anything about reality at all? It doesn't. We can make the same thing appear for a trillion years. And then next instant, not appear, and something else appear. It doesn't define us in the slightest bit. However long anything has been appearing, that still has zero definitional qualities. So that's why I say this whole world is zero. All appearance is zero. Okay, zero. Now, the fact that we see these appearances is perceiving them. We can say it's zero times zero, zero times zero. We just realize, you know, sure. This is an appearance now, but it has zero definitional qualities. Absolutely zero definitional qualities. There's no attachment to the form, no valuing. Valuing has to do with form, which has to do with time. Because we believe that definition, but it has to have time to it, right? Because if you say this is what we are, then that has to continue to be what we are in terms of a form, right? But we realize everything is intrinsically, I think the Buddha says, intrinsically sky-like nature, intrinsically empty. What it means is, it's an empty of value. It's empty of definitional value. It's a zero because it doesn't define what we are at all. It's not that the forms disappear. Appearances disappear. You don't have to make anything disappear. You don't have to make anything unmanifest. Everything is both manifest and unmanifest, always. Because instantly, you have the power to manifest or unmanifest everything, as it were. So, all this stuff becomes very understandable when you have a repentant move, a Buddha repentance, that say, the only problem I have is the continuity problem. It becomes, you know, pretty simple, a piece of cake. And you don't really have to talk shop about it too much, you know. And well, this teacher and that teacher, and you become part of the historical context. The best thing to do is for you to become part of the historical context. So the real historical context, the purpose of it, is for your awakening right now. Okay, that's the purpose of it. It's not to study it as a definition of something, okay? It's to study it to be inspired. It says, yes, I too, I can awaken to that also, and be equal, and realize the perfect equality of all. You should never get trapped in who's, you know, trying to judge and evaluate too much about this teacher higher, this teacher lower. That's a trap. Because the realization is the non-dual realization, the absolute. There is no definition of anything. There is no definition of higher teacher, lower teacher. There are no definitions. And it's easy to get pulled into that because some teachers were dualistic. You know, we're dualistic. But there have been plenty of ones who have realized the truth. And they're all equal, actually. They're all equal. Ultimately. Now, the only difference that there can possibly be among anyone is the severity of the continuity fear. There is no other difference whatsoever. So it's not a right way to look at different levels of teachers, whether you're a higher teacher, lower teacher. There's simply one problem, as the continuity problem. And some have zero continuity fear. Others still have a little bit. And some have more, and some have more, and some have very severe. But it's all exactly the same problem. So don't get caught up in judgment. Don't get caught up in judgment. Just say, no, there's only one problem, that's it. And historically, there have been many who have been free of the continuity fear, many. Who realize that there's no identity in form at all. There's no identity in form whatsoever. It's all zero. There have been many, which is fine. But on the other hand, you only need a few. You only need a few. Maybe you only need one. Maybe you only need one, actually. So you don't have to become some great scholar of the past. You just have to have this sense of, yeah, okay. It's many, many throughout the past. That's fine. You don't have to know their names or their dates or their, you know, this, where they attained it. That's all, you know, spiritual one-upmanship. Spiritual one-upmanship. It's kind of like to astonish and awe others. Wow. You know so much. You know so much. You're able to define so much. You're the king of definition or something. Now that's not where it's at. Where it's at is practicing the continuity problem, practicing that continuity problem, which is practicing repentance. And the more you do that, the easier all this non-dual teaching becomes to you. And it's self-evident. Truth is self-evident. Truth is entirely self-evident. So there's no such thing as there's somebody who's going to be greater than everybody else forever. That's ridiculous. All truth is 100% pure self-evident. So all of us are going to be totally realized. In fact, we all are right now. Everyone's already completely realized. It's just that in trying to turn our back on that, we have a continuity fear. Nobody's left reality. Nobody's left the peace of God at all. The peace of God is completely equal. There's no greater or lesser in the kingdom of heaven at all. Not really. Not really. Okay. And it can get a little confusing because the people, there are different realms, the astral, the causal, and the pure realm. But even so, the peace of God is equal, always, everywhere. There's no layers and levels in God, in pure spaciousness, none. There's no layers and levels in zero. Okay. But by and large, the planet has gotten off track to an alarming extent, to an extraordinary extent. And it's not a good thing at all for those who want to truly be established in the absolute. So perhaps it seems as though Jesus is contacting those in this world and saying, hey, would you like to come on over to my place? I had a resounding yes. You know? So I just said, yeah, nothing I'd like better than that. That's fantastic, of course. Now, some people like to have a teacher that represents the absolute, of course. Have zero continuity fear. Of course, that's great. Of course, that's great. Because then it makes you feel more secure. That is very important. And there's some that seem to have a higher profile than others, which is fine, too. None of that's an issue. Our issue is repentance. Repent, repent, repent. And realizing the continuity fear is quite severe. Quite severe. And so we're not going to be shedding it entirely anytime soon. Not entirely. We can shed a large chunk of it, actually, though. We can evaporate a large amount of it. But even in so doing, there will still be, you know, traces of it. And it takes a while to evaporate all of it. That is for sure. That is for sure. So don't be afraid you're going to be catapulted into the pure, you know, at the pure realm, the absolute pure realm. You cannot. You're already there. But it's a matter of realizing you're there. So you can't be catapulted into where you already are. Right? And your realization is entirely based on your continuity fear. And so there's no way you can, you know, throw yourself into that and abide in that as long as you have this continuity fear. It's just, your attention won't stay there. You know, you might be able to shift it just for an instant, but it won't stay there. It won't stay there. So you really don't have this, you know, much to worry about. The path of gradualism, you know, is the right way. Then you just keep working at it and keep doing the best you can at it. Keep being reassured. But it seems as though we're reaching a crescendo in this world where everyone's going to be underwater very soon. And that can have multiple meanings, right? They could be underwater as far as spiritually concerned. They're submerged in ignorance, submerged in emotionalism, right? Submerged in animalism. In the dream, I saw all these wild animals. It was the most incredible dream. It was like in the foothills, kind of looking up to some higher mountains, not real super high, but, and suddenly down the mountainside streamed all these groups of wild animals. Holy cow, I said, what is going on? All these wild animals, you know, like in Africa, you saw all these, and then I saw these gorillas, you know, a whole bunch of gorillas coming down the mountainside real fast. The zebras, the gazelles, rhinoceroses, the lion, I saw a lion, you know, and it's like, and just so many, many, many wild animals just streaming down from up above the hill there, coming down past me, and I was just like, had a video camera, I was like, taping, I said, whoa, what is this? What is this? Well, animalism, and they all came down into where the people were. Down below, in this huge, like, amusement park mall, the Great World Mall, and they all came down into that mall, so to speak, and it seems like the spirit of animalism is coming to the world. People are becoming more and more like animals. Have you noticed that? That's what I noticed when I went to the car wash. I said, people are getting freaky. If you want to put a finger on it, people are becoming more and more animalistic. Way more and more animalistic. And all the stuff that's on the media and the internet and the movies, the culture, the visual arts, the audio arts, just the collective world culture is emphasizing animalism, animalistic attitudes, behaviors. I just occasionally I catch in passing some of the television programs and I just listen to the soundtrack. I say, my God, everybody's like grunting and groaning and hee-hee-ho. They sound like animals, like human animals. This is not a joke. I am absolutely serious about this. And the intensity and the ferocity and the feral nature. I realized in the car wash, I said, everybody has this very feral nature about them. Where is the graceful, peaceful, spiritual nature of repentance? No, these people are very feral. They're like rhinoceroses. They're like animals. So what I realized is that the world has been training itself to for form here on this planet to be animalistic, very animalistic, very animalistic. And humans are now, most people are, have turned themselves in a very animalistic way, very animalistic way. No doubt about it. That's the pagan way, the barbaric way, secular humanistic way. And so they're spending time, as I said, this mall, this great world amusement park mall where I was. And everybody is just yucking it up like animals. You know, I don't like going around people anymore because they're so animalistic. It gets into me, you know? I feel it. If I'm around other people, I'll start having these animalistic ideas and thoughts. I say, what the hell? Where did that come from? I said, that's not me, you know. God, you get contaminated and you get around those people. Just as when you're around the sages and the saints, the animalistic nature seems to, you know, evaporate. But I'm in such a terrible place. This whole place is very animalistic, horrible. Silicon Valley is an extremely animalistic place. Say the least. Just the humor, what they find funny. They're really pretending to be animals. Yeah. If you look at these talk shows, these leaders of the talk shows, the on television and the shows, everything. They're really training you how to become animals. They're training you to become animals because it makes them feel safer. See. So yeah, I'm hanging out with animals. We're all animals here. We're all form. We don't have any spiritual nature. They're trying to get rid of their spiritual nature. Think that protects them. You cannot get rid of truth. The fact that God is everywhere, always. Pure spaciousness is everywhere. God is pure spaciousness. So where exactly is an animal going to go where they're not in pure spaciousness? They're 100% in pure spaciousness along with everything else. You can't escape God. You cannot escape God. It's stupid, you know. It's just ignorant. It's just foolish. And yet that's what they're doing. And so I can't stand the culture of this world. It is really revolting. It is truly revolting. And yet I've not found a place to go where you can really, you know, the vibration is truly spiritual. I don't know. I have to find a place. Jesus' house, maybe. Maybe that's what it boils down to, isn't it? Maybe that's what it boils down to. I don't want to go animal. I'm not going to go animal. You know, been there, done that. I looked at it. I saw what was going on. I looked at it, and then I said, you know what? That's not the answer. That is not the answer. It's a question of not judgment, but of pragmatism. What actually works? What's the real problem? Are you going to escape your problem, the continuity problem, through becoming animalistic? No, you won't. No, you won't. Because your spirit, you're free. You're still as God created you to be. That's the only demand God puts upon us, is that we always be what God created us to be. We can never escape that. And God is the isness of pure spaciousness, which is always equally everywhere. So you're always in God. Holistic, you know, is it doesn't work. It just simply doesn't. It will never work. So it's a waste of time. So it's not pragmatic, and that's what bothers me. You know, is pragmatism is all important here. So the need to escape this animalistic place, really, to get out of this situation. Is very important. I will see what the next step is. There does need to be a place of rest for us where we can decontaminate, so to speak, from this horrible animalistic planet, you know, really. People are, you know, they're obsessed with their pets, especially dogs. Dogs and pets tend to train us to be animalistic. And a lot of people, like, dog is my co-pilot, you know, the dogs are helped, they're training them to, yeah, you can be happy and nice and good person by being animalistic, okay. Again, that's not the answer. It's not the answer. People have to part way with animals. We're not here to relate with animals, to be animalistic. We're supposed to be supernatural. We're spirit. We're supposed to train to recognize, to accept our formlessness, to accept our complete non-definitionalness. This is the opportunity that we have. In no way, shape, or form should we be turning back to the animal kingdom for advice on how to be. And as I have said, people have become feral. This is like a feral planet now. And you can't get teaching through to someone who's non-repentant. It's not possible. You're just spinning your wheels because they're not processing what you say properly. Dualistic processing. And all they do is get frustrated with you, frustrated with the teaching. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. You can only the ones who have repented can truly benefit from the gospel, the good news. And repentance comes from within, where we realize, wow, this just doesn't work. It just doesn't work. And you know what? Even though the continuity problem is really severe, I just know. I got some sort of inner knowing. I know it can be resolved. It's just going to take a lot of work. That's all. That's what the Holy Spirit told me. It's going to take a lot of work. But guaranteed, you do that work, you are going to succeed for sure. And so I just said, okay, you know, I'll just do the work then. There's nothing else to do. Nothing else to do. But going animalistic is not the answer. That's not getting the job done. I mean, people pay way more attention to their dogs than they do other people, than they do God, than they do the Holy Spirit, than they do Jesus. I mean, to them, like, their dog is Jesus or something. You know, it's their spiritual totem. It's their totem, you know, spiritual, their animal totem. Something that somehow has all wisdom for them and all importance for them. And they're, you know, they think that they're getting it, you know. So the dog's helping them get it, you know, how to be animalistic. And of course, in days gone by, people have been very animalistic, very pagan, very barbarian. They watched animals and tried to mimic animals as far as how to be, you know, the power and the savagery and the cunning and all the qualities, you know, the animals, predatory animals and stuff. You know, they wanted to become that way to be safe. They felt, you know, that would give them an edge. That's not the gospel of salvation at all. That's not repentance at all. That doesn't work. So I have a basic disinterest in animals for the most part. And really overall, I don't have any really more interest in animals. I don't want any animals. Not interested in animals. There's no pets in Jesus' place. One thing I can say, in Jesus' house, going there, there are no animals there. There are no animals there. And people say, oh, can I bring my dog? They got to bring their dogs into every store with them. You see people just walking around in the stores with their dogs, and everybody's just like dog-centric, you know. Of course, it's the reverse of God, isn't it? D-O-G, reverse of G-O-D. It's animalism, animism. That's the religion of the planet right now. In many places, in many places. Remember, repentance is not some intellectual concept. It's a fact that the only problem we have is the continuity problem. There is no other problem. There is no other problem. Now, in the future, if you say no pets allowed, or no paganistic and animalistic attitudes allowed, it will be illegal. In fact, you'll have to allow pets and animals, you know, into your church service probably. People bring their dogs, you know, to church. Say, well, it helps me feel comfortable. It's more inclusive. I say the inclusiveness. They love that term. It's inclusive. They'll come to church naked with their dog smoking pot, and they'll say, yeah, man, this is just totally inclusive. Isn't this so much better? You know? Yeah. This inclusiveness. Yeah, right. They're excluding what works. How inclusive is that? If you exclude what actually works, how inclusive are you really being? Duh. Right? You see how stupid it is? This inclusiveness. Inclusiveness is just a code word for excluding what works. For excluding what works. That's all it is. It's a clever code word for that, so they can claim, oh, you're intolerant. No, they're intolerant of what works, is what's really going on. They're intolerant of what works, and they're very tolerant of what will never work. So in other words, they're ignorant. Ignorance is not going to get the job done. So you cannot have a world that outlaws what works and deifies what doesn't work and still claim any sort of authority whatsoever. Whatsoever. There's no authority. So I don't want to live in a world that has no authority, you know? I don't want to live in a place that doesn't have any authority. I want there to be authority. Authority means knowing what works. Otherwise, it's meaningless. Knowing what actually works is authority. So in a world that knows what works and insists that this is what we must pay attention to, that world has authority. So that's the kind of world I want to live in. I want to live in a world that has a genuine, actual authority. This world here is in no authority anymore. Breakdown of all authority here. That's not freedom, that's failure. That's not freedom, it's failure. God is ultimate authority. And God's demand is that we all remain as God created to be. That's authority. That's a fact. Can't change that fact. And that enables us all to function in perfect bliss and freedom and happiness, you see. So we don't want to be in a place with no authority. We don't want to be a place what doesn't work, you see. So we're turning all this propaganda around on the animus, the animalistic ones, the unrepentant ones, we will say. You know, their relentless propaganda war is being exposed for what it is. They're intolerant of what works. They're intolerant of any authority. They don't want any authority to stipulate what works. They want to be animalistic. They want to fail. Okay? There's no authority here. So how can they claim we have to stay here? There's no authority here to claim anything. Because authority is based on what works, and what they're pursuing doesn't work, so they don't have any authority. Get that? They don't have any authority to tell anybody what to do. They don't have any authority to tell anyone what to do. Awesome. That's great. Very helpful. Very helpful. Because we're getting down to this time when they're going to try and, you know, pull the authority card on us. They're only tolerant of what doesn't work and completely intolerant of what does work. Therefore, they don't have any authority. Don't have any authority. It's meaningless when they say they have authority. No authority. This world has no authority anymore. It doesn't have any authority. You can say only God has authority. Only the Holy Spirit has authority. Only what works has authority. Only Jesus has authority. or whatever represents to you, you know, that which is free of the continuity fear, truly free of it, you know, that, only that is authority. Only what is has authority. Only the truth has authority. Nothing else has authority. Truth is authority. Nothing else is authority. So again, say, I want to live in a world with authority there. Now the whole, this whole pagan archaic revival, which started in the late 50s and really blossomed in the 60s and the 70s and has kept on going. It was all anti-authority, you know. We hated authority. We wanted to tear down all authority, which really meant tear down what actually works. We were very unrepentant, you know, this was all these generations. We didn't want to say, we don't want to hate authority. But now I'm realizing how stupid that was. No, I love authority. I absolutely love authority. Last thing I ever want to do is live in a world with no authority. That's hell. That's hell. Which means nobody knows what works. Nobody knows what works. Everybody's in denial. Everybody's saying it's impossible to cure the fix, evaporate the continuity problem. So you're stuck. Everybody's stagnant and stuck. And then everybody starts tearing each other apart. You know, it's a horrible place. So, no, I want to dwell in a world that has absolute authority. Those who know, and say, this is what works. So I'm a repentant child of the 60s, you know. Repentant child of the 60s, absolutely. And the idea that Christianity doesn't work is not true. Because again, I've said, like in attending church, it humbles your spirit. And actually, nothing works better than humbling your spirit. That you're not special, because it's a collective, reality's collective creation, okay? Co-creation. We're all creating together, and it all harmonizes perfectly. We can't explain conceptually, dualistically, how that's possible. So it's not about being a diva. It's not about being some, you know, queen of the tribe, king of the tribe, leader of the tribe, and things like that. It's not tribal. It's not, you know, some leader. You know, it's not like that. So, you know, one of the best things anyone can do right now is just attend church, actually. Don't have to belong. I actually, let's say you don't have any religious affiliation, or you're not interested in this and this and that, fine. I suggest attend a Catholic church. Because you can just walk in, you find when Mass is, you just walk in, and you figure out what people are doing. Just kind of go along. They're just sitting in the back somewhere, nobody's side back, nobody's paying attention to you. And you can figure it out. I didn't know anything when I went to Catholic Church. And I just kind of, you know, read from the book, okay. Nobody's paying attention whether you're saying the creed or not. You don't even have to say it. Or, you know, just go there. Don't have to join the church at all. They're not going to say you have to join the church or anything. But you go there and you just start practicing being nobody important at all. Nobody important at all. And you may be some really important person, you think, in the world, but the world is becoming animalistic, and why do you want to be important in such a world? The world is breaking down, all authority is breaking down. Why do you want to be important, have status in such a world? So practice this feeling of, like, it doesn't matter who I am. It doesn't matter what my name is. It doesn't matter what my position is. None of that makes any difference to any of these people. And just hanging out in that atmosphere is super helpful, super, super helpful. You don't have to be a Catholic. Nobody's gonna look at your doors. Are you Catholic, you know? No, you're free to attend, and you don't have to go up and take the Eucharist. When I go up, you just cross your arms like this, you know? They say blessings upon you or something like that. You say amen, like that, thank you. And they always look very lovingly towards me. There's no rejection or anything like that. They feel like, thank you for being here. You know, just thank you for being here. It's very non-judgmental, actually, I've experienced. Very much so. So you can be an agnostic, you know, have many different flavors, ecumenicalism, universalism, it doesn't matter. But the experience that you are not important in terms of your persona, your definition of what you are is not important. That's what you get. Your definition of what you are is not important. That's the experience you get, actually, by going there. Your definition is of what you are is not important. And you know, it won't happen immediately, but you'll start feeling this like, wow, because no definition is important. No definition at all is important. No definition is true. And therefore, they're all false. And all lies are equally lies. So all definitions are equally false. All definitions of what we are equally false. So it gets to just some actual pragmatic practice in this. I say, go to Catholic Church. Don't have to be a Catholic at all. Don't have to believe anything they say. Or you can if you want. It doesn't matter. But it's this experience, like my definition of what I am makes no difference here. Nobody cares. It's irrelevant. Totally irrelevant. Wow. I like that. That is very cool. And I don't have to act like somebody else's definition is important either. And you can come in there first time and you say, hey, nobody here is any better than I am either. You know, nobody's better than I am. Nobody's greater. Nobody's lesser, really. Now, there may be differences in different Catholic churches all over the world. I'm sure there's some that are somewhat clubby and social, possible. Certainly, where I go, no, there's very little of that, very little of that. Because there's a lot of influx of new people, a lot of immigrants here, a lot of immigrants. Almost everyone, the new catechumens are Hispanic, almost all. And then there's also, you know, Vietnamese and Filipinos and different people from all over the world, and a lot of them don't even speak English, you know, and so there's not much of a social atmosphere at all, actually, which is really cool. It's very cool. Nobody thinks anything of you, you know. You're not important. Not your definition is not important, and that is super great training for the Kingdom of Heaven. Super great training. Because there, you will practice collective creativity, which is harmonized by God. And then comes back to everyone. And it's better than any individual input at all. It's the sum, you know, it's greater than the parts, so to speak. And it's just like, wow, this is so much better than the animalistic creativity of this planet, the definitional creativity. Wow. This is just like night and day. It's night and day better. Take the greatest art in this world, and the least creativity in the kingdom, the very least, is way greater than the very best creativity in this world. Way, night and day better. Night and day better. Okay. It's living, for one thing. It's now. It's fresh. It's ever fresh. The presence is ever fresh. The responsiveness is ever fresh. It's always there. It's night and day better. Okay, again, you take all of the great creative expression of this planet throughout forever here, and the greatest amount you can ever get, the most wonderful you can ever get here, still, the very least in the collective creativity of the Kingdom of Heaven is night and day superior to it. Night and day superior to it. So why hang around this planet? Why hang around this animalistic realm? When this is the case, it'll never satisfy you. Never satisfy you. Now, I don't know exactly, when I say why hang around here, I don't know exactly how it's going to play out. There's some way it's going to play out here. It's all set up somehow. It's all set up. So don't despair. While you're here, continue. Be smart. Be wise. Be repentant, as I've suggested. I'm not asking anyone to become a Catholic at all. I'm not even a Catholic. But you can go to any church. I just believe they leave you alone there. You get the feeling of, doesn't matter who you are, we're not even interested in you at all. And you don't have to be interested in us, and just you can just be there. Just like, how do you get better than that? And the doors are always unlocked. You can go in there anytime you want. I just thought that was fabulous, where Just go into any Catholic church anywhere and just sit down there. And, you know, you're not important. Nobody's important. And it's just like, wow, what is this? Whereas, the Christian churches, their doors are locked, and they open them up for, you know, the services, and they have your things, and you're part of a club, you're part of a tribe, sort of thing. Whereas in the Catholic Church, there's no tribe, really. There's no tribalism, at least in what I'm familiar with. And I've attended various different Catholic churches, actually. And it's always been the same for me, that you feel like it's okay if you're there, and it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter if you don't know anybody. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And I've never felt awkward. I've never felt awkward. So it's the way it's set up. So it helps. So that's one thing. The other thing is to practice the continuity practice. And I hope these videos can help. Use your time wisely. Use your time wisely now. Be repentant. If this is soaking in, if spiritual teaching soaks into you, then you're repentant. If you're trying to figure out intellectually, then you haven't repented yet. So keep working at repentance. That's why I'm not trying to help. Keep working at repentance, which just means, repentance means you finally accept that the continuity problem can be resolved, even though you think it's going to take a lot of work. That's all it means. You finally accepted, okay, I believe it can be resolved. Instant repentance. That's it. That's what happened to me in 1978. I've been repentant since 1978. And I said, okay, I see this can be resolved. I trust the Holy Spirit. It's just going to take a lot of work. Yes, okay, let's start working on it. Been going to Catholic churches for 15 years now, probably. I started just going, taking photography. I started getting to, I tried to find beautiful sacred places. So I started going, I found the Catholic churches were very beautiful and peaceful. And I'd go in there and I'd take photographs and sit there and walk in the gardens and stuff. And I'd visit all the missions, of California. Spent time in the missions. Spent a lot of time in the missions of California. And gradually I said, wow, this is so peaceful. There's just no pressure. It's like, wow, what is this? And gradually, I spent more time. Now I'm just a regular once a weeker. There's some beautiful, 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 beautiful churches, and just wow, just hanging out here. It gives it just a different vibe. And I'm sure it's different all places. There's some differences culturally, of course. Yeah, but you get the gist of what's being said here. And it can be any place. You can go any place where you feel you're nobody important at all. And nobody else thinks they're important. It just doesn't matter. The definition of what you are, what they are, here, it doesn't matter. We're all in God here, beyond definition here. Here we come to experience that we are. Not definitional. We are not definitional at all. God is non-definitional. We don't need to say God is non-denominational. No. God is non-definitional. God is non-definitional. So you come here and you experience the non-definitionalness in a group of people there. Nobody has to know your name. You have to know their name. You don't have to socialize with them, because we're here to say, you know what? To God, we're non-definitional entirely here. This will get you ready. So repentance means to accept I have a continuity problem. Keep working on repentance. Attend some situation where you're in a group, where you get this feeling where you're non-definitional. It's not important who you are at all. You don't have to say a word. Nobody's ever asked me to say anything in Catholic Church. Nobody's asked me to ever do anything. Actually, one time I collected the voluntary donation basket one time. That's it. Maybe I didn't do a very good job. I've never been asked for anything else to do anything else at all. Just like a nobody. That's perfect. That's perfect. It's absolutely perfect. Very interesting. Very interesting. Hard to say that about any other situation, right? You don't have to give your opinion on anything. You don't have to weigh in on anything. You don't have to debate anything. You don't have to talk. And nothing. You don't even have to sing. A lot of people, one of the spouse is Catholic, the other's not, but they come together, you know. So there's a lot of people there that are not Catholics, actually. So you don't need to give your opinion on anything. It doesn't matter. Because again, there's only one problem. And that's the continuity problem. It's your belief that what you are, the definition is possible. And you need to gradually drop this. You need to repent to get into the kingdom of heaven for sure. Absolutely. Otherwise, the kingdom of heaven won't make any sense to you whatsoever. It'll feel like an abyss. You must repent, which is to say, confess. I have a severe continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. Now, this is a better confession than the Catholic Church confession. I don't say that the liturgy of the Catholic Church is as good as it needs to be. It's not. It's not. But you're not going to change it or improve it. That doesn't matter. You get a better liturgy here, actually, than the Catholic Church. But going to church gives you a better experience of being unimportant. Your definition of what you are is unimportant. So, in that way, I'm super supportive. But the liturgy, no, liturgy is a mess. It's a mess. You can do way better than that. But that doesn't matter. It's okay. If you have this, you know that repentance means to say, I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem that I have. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a definition problem. I have a continuity problem. See, the definition problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Now, I found in Catholic Church, sometimes the priests say something that's profound, sometimes not. Sometimes they mix the two up. Sometimes the priests are very learned, and they understand that most of the people there don't get it so much, what they're saying, and they'll slip in a lot of profundity. Some of the people in church actually are very spiritual. A few here and there, actually. And they really can feel, you know, the love for, you know, is really amazing. And it differs, you know. You get different priests all the time. Different priests come. Sometimes a bishop comes, you know. And some of them have really can feel the love and the charity, the feeling of equality, of equal love. It actually is present. You know, it really is to some extent. But again, the liturgy is a hodgepodge. It's a hodgepodge. And they, you know, they have their, you know, things that are important to them, you know. But whether you agree with those or not doesn't matter at all. It doesn't matter. I tend to agree with most of the positions they have, the church has, on my own, from my own merit, though, my own understanding. But if there's something, you know, that they say, it's all kind of like laid back. It's laid back. It's okay. Understanding human nature, it gets caught up in issues. That's fine. Laid back, though. Laid back. And maybe some people say, how dare he suggest that, you know, that. Man, keep in mind, to get in the kingdom of heaven, one must repent, and also it's very helpful to have your spirit humbled as far as the definition of what you think you are. Have that humbled. Around other people, you know, I find it very difficult to be humbled just by myself here. It just doesn't seem to work. When you're around other people and they realize they don't care who you are, and there's really no opportunity to show off or say, hey, I'm look what I can do. There's not, you just gotta sit there like everybody else. Just sitting there, not being able to say anything, is like an incredible spiritual practice for humbling your spirit. Maybe that's why St. Francis, you know, greeted me as a brother. Because he, you know, he was, you know, tremendous saint of humility, right? And maybe he says, hey, you get it, you know, welcome, welcome. I sort of welcome into the, you know, the brotherhood, as it were, of humility or whatever it is, you know. That's a very profound experience. Because that's what it's really about. Now, you don't have to go out and feed the poor. There are ways to develop the humility of spirit, going out, Jesus washing the feet of, you know, the feet of, and going out, giving charity, helping others, and all that. They do all that stuff. I haven't done any of that. I did it earlier on my own, but I don't feel called to do that. That's okay. That's okay. That's one way. There are different ways to develop, you know, this humility. But just sitting there, not being able to say anything or do anything, nobody asks your opinion on anything, and nobody ever will. That's like great. That's like great. Nobody's interested in my opinion on anything. And I think, I'm sitting there thinking, oh my God, you know, I could fix this liturgy, I could fix this theology. I mean, it's just like, you guys are just all messed up. What's this? Nobody cares. Nobody's ever going to ask me to fix it. Which is great, because again, the only problem there is the continuity problem. I don't have a theology problem, I have a continuity problem. That's a fact. I do not have a I do not have a liturgy problem, I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have, it's the only problem there is the only problem anyone has, actually. That's it, there is no other problem. There will never be a liturgy problem, right? There will never be a theology problem. There will never be a sacrament problem. The only problem there will ever be is the continuity problem. That is it. There is no other problem. Never be any other problem other than the continuity problem. And the vision of oneness is what resolves the continuity problem. Therefore, that's the only value there is in existence. In all of existence, in all of definition, there will only be one value. Right now, there's only one value. That's the vision of oneness. That's it. There is nothing else of value. Ground yourself in that. Ground yourself in that. Humble your spirit, so your opinions, your dualistic, thought-based opinions don't matter, because they don't matter. In the kingdom of heaven, nobody's going to ask you what your theology is. What you're doing is you're experiencing collective creativity, and the light is present, and God is present to harmonize all that, and you're experiencing that. And you say, this is better than anything in that, you know, anything in that realm that thought they had all these problems and stuff. It's better. And then you start remembering your functionality. That's how you remember your functionality, right? We have to remember our functionality. We have to get used to our functionality again. It's like someone has been in an accident and paralyzed, and they get there, finally the paralysis goes away, and they've forgotten how to walk. You know, they have to be retrained how to move. We've forgotten how to function. So we need to reacquaint ourselves with our true functionality, which is this collective co-creation with God, which is both unique and individual and collective at the same time. And Jesus says, you can't explain that, but it's true. And I trust that what he says is true. You don't lose your individuality and your uniqueness. Even though you're collectively created, your creativity is always collective. You don't lose it, but it's a harmonious experiencing. And I just believe what Jesus says is true, and so I go in that direction. So I hope this has been helpful. I'm doing the best I can. Doing the best I can. Again, I'm a pragmatist. Okay, I am a pragmatist, which has authority. Only pragmatism has, only what works is authority. So I bring the authority of the Holy Spirit, what is shown me what works, and I'm bringing it here to the world and saying, with some authority, you know, this is pragmatism. Don't be an idealist, be a pragmatist. Do what actually works, okay? And you will succeed. And that's how you succeed. That's how you succeed. Remember, you don't want to be in a realm that doesn't have any authority. You want to live in a realm that has authority. Oh yes, that's what I pray for. Holy cow. That is the best. Because you'll be told what to do. You say, this is what you need to do, and it's going to work for you. And then you do it, and it works for you. Well, how could anything be better than that? How could anything be better than that, you know? God. So this world's becoming just untenable, you know, untenable, really. You can't give up pragmatism. You have to have authority in this world. Say, look, this works, and this doesn't. And that's why I get upset. You know, I get upset at the Pope, for sure. I don't like the direction the Pope is taking the church in. The Pope has to stand for pragmatism. The Pope has to stand for authority. The Pope has to say, this is what works. This is what humbles your spirit. This is what you need. You need your spirit to be humbled. Okay. And we all need that. We all need that. And I can get into a lot of talk about this, but I won't do it in this video. We need to do what works. And looking back in hindsight, you say, thank God I did what worked. Thank God I didn't keep being stupid. Thank God there was some authority that knew what worked and guided me to do what worked. You know, thank God. Otherwise, I would still be down in that hell, you know, and I'd be acting like an animal, like these other poor souls that are still, you know, suffering from their belief of the continuity fears impossible to solve. And denying that anyone's ever solved it, therefore, you know, and refusing to spend any time considering it because they say, why waste time on what's impossible? You know, they're stagnant right now. They're stagnating. And they'll have to come out of that stagnation, which they will, because they'll get tired of it. You know, you get tired of being animalistic, for sure. Doesn't really do. You really do. Remember, St. Francis was very animalistic, very pagan. He got tired of it. He said, this isn't it, man. This, you know, he's a party animal. He was a pagan party animal, St. Francis. Rich, stuck, snobbish, all the bad qualities of paganism. And he just said, you know, this isn't going to work. He became a pragmatist. Got rid of all the stuff, you know, and said, hey, this, I'm going to do what works. I'm going to do what works. And it worked. Very great. That's it for this one.